Let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it. And his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. For he is our God.
Good morning, and welcome to online worship with Central Baptist Church of Crandall, Texas. We're so glad that you joined us today. If you're new with us, we hope you'll indicate that by typing "I'm new" in the comment box below. That will help us to know that you've joined with us today, and one of our moderators will be glad to contact you and say welcome to our online worship. We have many things happening at the church these days. One thing we're emphasizing in the month of September, we're pushing hard to meet our goal for our global mission offering for this fiscal year. We set a goal of $106,000 for missions, and we're growing close. We're getting close to meeting that goal. And we hope that you'll give generously to help us finish out the goal by the end of September. I'm happy to tell you that we're having a big women's teleconference here at our church on September the 26th. This will go from 8:30 in the morning until 4:30 in the afternoon. It will include lunch. The cost is $20. You have tomorrow to make your reservation. If you want to participate in the conference, tomorrow, Monday, is the last day. So I hope you'll call and make a reservation to participate in the women's conference. We're going to have Beth Moore, Priscilla Shire, many wonderful speakers and worship leaders. You'll be glad to join the ladies in this women's conference on September the 26th. Our church is resuming its Wednesday night program, our complete Wednesday night program for preschool, children, adults, youth. Everybody will resume their Wednesday night programming on September the 16th. And I especially want to invite you to come to our prayer meeting because I'll be beginning a series of lessons on the Gospel of John. So we're happy to announce that we're resuming our complete Wednesday night programming on September the 16th. Brother Charlie asked me to encourage you to pray for the prayer requests that he's designated for each week. During the month of September, he's preaching on prayer each week, and we have certain points that we're emphasizing for prayer each week. And so he's encouraging you to remember those and pray for those special prayer requests week by week. Our annual church conference is coming up Sunday evening, September the 27th. This will be at 5 p.m. September the 27th. This is the church conference where we elect officers, we approve committees, we approve the church budget, we approve the church missions budget. So we're hoping everyone can come. Now, this will be an in-person meeting in the church auditorium, 5 p.m. September the 27th. You want to come and have a say and a vote in our church's business. Speaking of business, we really do encourage you to give to the church, and certainly our members have been very faithful to do that this year. There are various ways in which you can give to the church. You can give on the church app. You can give through the church website. You can mail your gift to the church. You can bring your gift by the church. Or if you need someone to pick it up, we'll be glad to send a deacon to pick up your gift. But we pray that you'll be faithful in giving as we honor the Lord in giving our tithes and offerings. Now let's pause and dedicate this service to the Lord. Our Heavenly Father, we give thanks for the opportunity that we have to worship online, Truly, the ability to worship over the internet is a marvel to us, but we give thanks for this opportunity. Lord, we just pray that the service to follow will lift up the Lord Jesus Christ and serve to honor and glorify His holy name. And it's in His name that we pray. Amen.
I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard and to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Word of God, speak. I'm finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise. All that I need is to be with you and to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see, oh, your majesty, to be still and know you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see, oh, your majesty, to be still and know your let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Word of God, speak. I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay.
Good morning. What a great joy it is to open the Word of God again together, and I pray that you will open your Bibles to 2 Chronicles chapter 20 today. Last week, we began an emphasis on prayer here in our church through the month of September. And during the month of September, we're trying to refocus on prayer, literally thinking a whole new way about prayer, if that's possible, more like getting back to the basis of what prayer is. Thinking about prayer in a whole new way, one element in thinking about prayer in a whole new way is to learn to thank God in advance when we pray. Now, when we thank God after a prayer request has been given to us, or we've had an answer to prayer, that's gratitude. But thanking God before we pray, that's faith. Let me ask you a question. If I were to call you and say to you that we've been going through difficult times, I know that you've been having a difficult time in your life, and so the Lord's put it on my heart that for the next 4 months, I'm going to pay your mortgage payment. And you would think in your mind, well, Brother Charlie is an honest guy, and if he says something, he means it. He wouldn't call me if he wasn't serious about it. And you're going to receive that expression of my love to help you out. Let me ask you the question is this. Would you begin thanking me during the phone call, or you would you wait until you received the check, deposited the check, and it cleared the bank? Well, I think most of us say, well, no, Brother Charlie, I would thank you because you said you were going to do it, and I know that you're going to keep your word, and I'm just going to trust that you're going to do that, and I'd begin expressing thanks for you. Well, that's what I'm talking about when I'm talking about thanking God in advance is faith. And I don't think we do that normally in our prayer time. I think most of the time that our thankfulness for our answered prayer is gratitude. And yet, Jesus was very specific about prayer. And he said that if we are to give God thanks before we pray. For example, in Mark's Gospel, chapter 11, and verse 24, Jesus said these words, "Anytime you ask for anything in prayer, believe you have received it, and you will receive it." Now notice the words. He said, believe you have received it. That's past tense. And then you will receive it. That's future. So you might ask, well, you know, is Jesus saying you have to believe you have it even if you don't have it to receive it? And the answer is that's exactly what Jesus said. So let's just look at it again. Are we saying that we have to believe something is so even when it isn't so, so that it will be so? And again, that's exactly what Jesus was saying, but that's not typically what we do in prayer. And one of the reasons we don't do that in prayer, in my opinion, is because that most of our prayer is not a prayer for breakthrough. In other words, there's many prayers that we pray. Before I bring this message, I've been praying for God to anoint this time and bless me and bring thoughts to my mind and let me be able to communicate clearly to help me as I preach this message. But it wasn't a breakthrough prayer. A breakthrough prayer, as we talked about last week, is that we need God to move beyond that which is common and ordinary and to do that which is miraculous. Remember, we talked about a breakthrough as that it's an advancing something that's important to us. It's bringing it to pass. And most of the time, thankfully most of the time, we're not praying for breakthrough prayers. But in this time in our life, in the life of our country, in the life of our church, our culture, I think we are more desperate than ever for God to break through and give us a breakthrough. Just like we're praying that God will give us a scientific breakthrough for a shot, a injection for the virus that is the pandemic across our world. And certainly we're praying that that'll be a breakthrough. Well, just as we're praying for a scientific breakthrough, I think in my life and in our lives, we often come to the place in our life where we need a spiritual breakthrough. And so that's what I'm talking about this month. How to pray a prayer for a breakthrough in our life. And so that's our focus. Thanking God after He gives us something, that's gratitude. And every prayer ought to be including in our prayer time gratitude. We ought to be thankful for what God has done. But thanking God in advance, before it's ever happened, that is the prayer of faith. Both are important. When praying for a breakthrough, we need to pray in faith, not just to be thankful for what God has done. The breakthrough faith is not continuing to beg God for something over and over and over again, but to pray in faith, that is, we continue to thank Him for what He is going to do. And so the great illustration, I think, in all the Bible of a breakthrough prayer, certainly this is one of them at least, is the prayer of Jehoshaphat in 2 Chronicles chapter 20. And we're going to look at that today. But it's illustrated in many places in the Bible. For example, God spoke to Abraham and He said that He was going to make him a father of many people, as more than the stars in the heaven. And yet, He waited 25 years for the son to be born to he and his wife. He didn't beg him for 25 years every day, God, give me a son, give me a son. He received the fact that God had promised that he was going to do that, and he thanked him for 25 years. But 25 years he waited for that to come to pass. And so when we're praying for a breakthrough, it doesn't mean that God's going to automatically do it in this, the next moment or the next 10 moments. But God is going to keep his word. And we're going to see that in our message today. And I just tell you, I'm praying for a breakthrough for our church. I can tell you, as I was thinking about this message and the text that I'm going to use, about 3 years ago, I remember being over here on a Saturday morning, and I was praying for our congregation and praying for our community, and the Lord just put it on my heart to begin to walk around this property and a prayer walk and praying. And as I was walking around and praying, I was asking God to give us a breakthrough here. I was praying for this campus to be literally filled with building and cars and people. An activity that was going on here as God was stirring hearts in our community. I can tell you, I learned that about 35 years ago in another opportunity I had to lead a church as their pastor. And I saw that come to pass. And it was this text that God led me to do it then, and it's this text that encourages me to do it now, to have a breakthrough. Last week, we mentioned this inspiring story, and we've talked about the base of prayer. I tried to give you a hand in prayer, literally, and if you didn't get this, I pray that you will, but the challenge to pray three times a day and to begin with just praying about the things that Jesus taught us to pray and how to pray in the model prayer, and then who to pray for and what to pray for on the inside. I hope that you'll use this, and again, my challenge is for us to pray three times a day. That, again, is general prayer, and we pray that every day of our life, hopefully three times in a day, you'll be focusing on prayer in your life. But you and I know that there are some times in your life, there's times in my life, where I just can't pray generally, as good as that is, that I need to pray for God to do something beyond that which is ordinary. Extraordinary, that God would break through miraculously, for there's no help. And so in the story that we're going to look at today, again in chapter 20 of 2 Chronicles, King Jehoshaphat says these words. Listen to the word of God. Verse 1, after these things, the enemy nations united to attack King Jehoshaphat. Spies told him, a huge combined army is marching to Jerusalem right now to defeat you. Scared and worried, King Jehoshaphat, listen to this, resolved to seek the Lord. And he announced a nationwide fast. We're going to talk more about fasting in the couple weeks. And we've called our church to a fast for Monday, September the 21st. And we're going to ask you to join us, if that's at all possible for you to join us. And he announced a nationwide fast so that everyone came together to fast and to pray to seek help from God. When they all got to the temple in Jerusalem, the king stood up and he prayed aloud. And in this prayer time, we're going to think about that today, this prayer for a breakthrough. Man, they were going to be destroyed if God did not step through. They had no power to stand against these three armies that were united and coming against them in one giant force. There was no way that they were going to be able to withstand them. So he prayed privately. That's the first thing he did. And then he prayed with others. We're going to see that in the message today. And then he called the people together at a public prayer meeting. They come together because they understood the importance of prayer. I pray that you understand that. I pray that God is helping me to better understand that every day of my life. The king at a public prayer meeting. And, you know, we are powerful when we pray together. I have a group of prayer partners that I pray with. They pray with me, and sometimes we'll get a text, and it'll go out to all of us, and so-and-so needs prayer urgently at this moment. And just that quick, we are joined together, and we're praying, lifting up that particular need. There's power in prayer, and we've seen God literally do the miraculous through that. But instead of worrying, what we always do. The king worshiped God. That's what we're going to see in our text today. He didn't seek counsel from anyone else before he sought counsel from the Lord. He went to the Lord first, and he set his face before the Lord. Why? Because he was serious. And I want to say something. You know, it's true. Whatever has your attention has you. This had his attention. He wanted to give his attention to God because he needed God's help. There was no help for them apart from God in this. And so I'm going to talk about principles of prayer to have a spiritual breakthrough, to have a breakthrough in your life. I think these principles are essential for you to practice and for me to practice in my life. So let's look at them today. Number one, the principle for praying, for have a breakthrough in our life, number one is start by focusing upon God, not on the crisis. That sounds very logical, but it's not really what we do. We usually are so focused on the crisis, we hardly get to God. But it begins by start focusing on God and not the crisis that we're facing. How do we do that? Notice what the Bible says. Look at verse 3. Jehoshaphat was afraid, so he set his face to seek the Lord. Here's how he did that. Number one, he reminded himself of God's greatness. And we need to remind ourselves of God's greatness. Look at verse 6. O Lord, are you not the God who is in heaven? You rule over every kingdom and nature. You are so powerful and mighty that nothing and no one can defeat you. He was reminding himself of who God is. And that's where it has to start. If we're going to have a breakthrough in our life, it begins by getting our focus on God, who is the only one that can help us really in times of desperate need. He did not focus on his problem. I want to tell you what I've learned in my life is that the bigger that God is in my mind, the smaller the problem is in my mind, the smaller it becomes. Because God can eclipse those problems. When I focus on God and His majesty and His glory and who He is, as the Bible says, with man, there are many things that are impossible, but with God, nothing is impossible. I'm telling you, when I'm desperate, when the world just seems to be collapsing on me and there's no hope to be found, I need to be reminded that there is hope because God is greater than any problem I'm ever going to face in my life. So I need to remind myself of who God is. Number two, I need to remind myself of God's unlimited power. I know I've said that, but verse 7, look at what he said. And God, did you not drive out those who tried to keep us from living here when you brought us back home? Of course, he's referring to the Exodus when the children of Israel were in the promised land, and the Bible says a great famine came on the land, and they ended up in Egypt, and they were out of their land for those 400 years. Well, when Moses was going to lead them back into their land, there were other people who had occupied the land. And guess what? They didn't want Israel to come back into the land that God had given them. And so the king is reminding them that armies had stood against Israel before. Armies had stood against God's plan and purpose and will for His people before. But God had always come through because He had unlimited power. He was a God who was able to open the Red Sea. He was a God that was able to help them traverse the River Jordan on dry land. Those were miracles that God had done because God has all power. I don't have to have the power. Listen to me. If God has the power, that's the thing that I need to worry about. The king reminded himself that God had been faithful. And we know that if I'm going to obey God, then I have to have faith. And where do I get faith? I get faith by, number one, reading the Word of God. When I read the Word of God, I'm reminded of how great God is and His unlimited power. But I also get faith, not just by reading the Word of God, but by recalling and remembering how that God is a faithful Father and how He's never failed me yet. And He's not going to start now. And so the second thing is that I remind ourselves of God's unlimited power. Number three, he reminded himself of God's promises to His people. Notice what he said again in verse 7. And also, did you not give this promised land to your friends Abraham's descendants to be theirs forever? The very place that they were staying right here at this time was called the Promised Land. Now, why is it called the Promised Land? Well, because God promised it to His people. Listen to me. If God promises something, God is going to fulfill and keep His promise. And so we look in the Word of God, and when we read the Word of God, we find promise after promise of God speaking to us. Now, you know, I was thinking about this. As parents, sometimes we don't want to hear our kids remind us, but Mom, Dad, you promised us. Now, here's one reason that we don't, is because sometimes what they consider to be a promise was not literally a promise that we made. It was a misunderstanding, or they just assumed certain things was going to happen, and I never said that it was, or their mom never said that it was going to be that way. And that's how it is with us sometimes. Sometimes we can look at a piece of passage in the Word of God and say, well, that's what God said. That's a promise. Well, many, many, many of God's promises are conditional. I will do this if you will do these things. It's not I'm just going to do this, but there are some conditions to be met. But there are some promises that are absolutely God's promise that's going to be fulfilled no matter what. And I can tell you, my friend, one of those promises is that God is going to love His family. And God is a perfect father. And if God makes a promise, then God is going to fulfill that promise. Doesn't matter who you are. God is never bothered when we remind Him of His promises that He has made in His Word to us as we live. And so we can be thankful for that. Here's one of the promises we talked about last week, that God will supply all of your needs. I want to tell you, my friend, I can hold on to that promise. David held on to that promise. He said, once I was old and I was young, now I'm old. I've never seen the righteous forsaken nor a seed begging for bread. I want to tell you something, my friend. When God makes a promise, God will keep His promise. He's not bothered by us reminding of His promise. The king reminded to God, God, here's your promise. Here's the promise that you made. I'm telling you, that was an insult. That was not a bother to God. I believe it was a blessing to God. You know, I enjoy when I have made a promise to one of the twins, and they come back and they remind me, hey, Papa, do you remember you said that you were going to do this? I tell you, it's joyous in my heart when they remind me of a promise I made, because it tells me they believe me when I made that promise. And I can tell you that I'm going to do everything in my power to fulfill that promise. Now, certainly, there's going to be promises I make to my kids that I don't fulfill because I'm limited in so many things. It was my best intention that I would have done it if I could have, but I can't. But I'm telling you, God is a perfect Father, and there's not anything that He's ever promised that He's not going to fulfill. Hallelujah. And we can rejoice in that. And finally, here's a fourth thing. He asked God for a breakthrough. He said, our enemies want to destroy us. Will you not stop them from defeating us? We need to be specific in our prayer life. And I say that because too often our prayer life is so general, we would never know if God answered that prayer or not. For instance, some people say, well, God, I want you to bless my life. Listen to me. Define to me what a blessing is. You know, some of us talk about a blessing in disguise. You know what we're saying? There was a problem they thought was going to be horrible, but it turned out that God used it for our good. And it was a blessing in disguise. When you say, God bless me, you're saying, God, pour out your problems in my life. He was very specific. And we need to learn to pray specifically about what our requests are and what we're asking of God. He said, God, our enemies want to destroy us. Will you not stop them? Are you not? Did you not? Will you not? The king was very specific. When you're praying for a breakthrough in your life, you need to pray, my friend, specifically about it, very serious, if obviously about it, but be specific about it. I'm going to ask Chris to come and lead us in a prayer right now. I just don't want to talk about prayer. Today, we want to pray together.
Let's go to Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank You so much for Your love, Your grace, and Your mercy. Lord, I pray that You forgive us of our sins. I pray that that you forgive us for not seeking your face each and every day. I pray that you forgive us for not loving you with our mind, with our heart, with our soul, with all of our strength. And Lord, I pray that you forgive us for not loving our neighbor as we should. Lord, I pray that we realize how great and awesome you are. Lord, I pray that we have a realization of that, that you bring that anew, afresh in our lives. Lord, help us to have an urgency to love you, to seek you. Lord, create that urgency in our heart. Lord, help us to be a congregation, a people, a church who seek your face, who deliberately seek your face, who deliberately open up your word and read it and pray each and every day. Lord, I pray that we be a church, that we crucify ourselves each and every day so that you may be honored, that you may be glorified. Lord, I pray for this pandemic. Lord, I pray for the people who aren't able to attend our assembly. Lord, help them to feel like they are part of our church, because they are. Lord, help them to know that you're there with them when they're worshiping you in their homes, that you're there, your spirit is there with them. And Lord, just help them to feel part of the body of Christ. I pray that we become a church, that we seek your face, and that we deliberately do so. Lord, give us strength, give us courage. Lord, help us to be like Paul, to realize that this life is a race and that we are to run the race with endurance, and that our goal is you, and that we keep our eyes focused on you all of our life. Lord, I pray that we not be a church that is comfortable, but Lord, help us to be uncomfortable for you. Lord, help us to run the race with endurance. Help us to strive. Help us to stretch. Help us to reach for you each and every day. Thank you, Lord, for your love, your grace, and your mercy. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
I appreciate that prayer, Chris, and what a blessing it is. The second principle that I want to give you today is this. Confess our helplessness to get the victory. Confess that we are helpless to accomplish the thing that is before us. In other words, God, if you don't come through, if you don't do this, it's absolutely not going to happen. A breakthrough prayer is not simply asking God for help. As I said last week and today already, many of my prayers are not breakthrough prayers. They're asking for God to help me, to give me wisdom, to give me strength, to help me have a recall and remember the things that I've studied or scripture verses that I want to be sure that I bring up and share with the congregation as I preach, or to help me be safe as I drive to and fro to the church campus about each day of my life. But when I'm needing a breakthrough prayer, I'm saying, God, I am powerless. God, I can't do this. Will you resolve this? It's more like, help. Help me now, God. Please help me. Deliver me from this situation that I'm facing. Look at verse 12. He said, Lord, we are powerless against these mighty armies that are coming in to attack us. And we don't know what to do, but we are looking to you for help. He said, Lord, I don't have the power, and if I did, I wouldn't know what to do with it. But I am focused on you, God. I'm not focused on my abilities to accomplish this, because it's so far beyond me. But God, I know that you can, and I know that you will. And so I'm counting you. That's my focus. We're powerless. And God, you're powerful. You know, if you've ever struggled with addictions and you've been to one of the programs that offer steps to your recovery, I think every one of them begins right here. You have to admit that I'm powerless to change myself. Listen to me. That's where we have to be in breakthrough prayer. We have to say, God, I can't. And if you were to give me the ability, I wouldn't know how to do it. It's beyond me. I have to have you to deliver me from this. You have to break these chains that enslave me. And we have to wait and trust God's timing. You know, most of the time, I can't do anything about most things in my life. Sometimes faith is doing nothing. And I say that because when we're waiting for our breakthrough, the temptation is that we somehow have to do something in taking back control of the situation. I'm telling you, if I could have done it, then I should have already done it. When I'm talking about a breakthrough prayer, I'm talking about I'm in a situation where I understand more than anybody that there is not one thing that I can do. And sometimes waiting on God to move is a very difficult time. I can just imagine how Abraham must have felt many times in his life, waiting to 25 years, to his 100 years of age, which was a physical impossibility, even in Abraham's time, for him to father a child. And yet God brought about a miracle in his life, but he had to wait on God's timing, and so that's very hard sometimes. Notice what it says in verse 13. Then all the men of Judah stood before the Lord waiting.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you, my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. You're the one, it's Christ in me. Oh, Lord, I need you. Teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And when I cannot stand, I fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you.
My goodness, how hard it is to wait on the Lord, isn't it? But you see, God is not a genie in the bottle. We're not demanding things of God. We're asking God, I'm your child, God. If you don't come through, there's no help. There's no hope for me in this situation. And then we are willing to wait on God and wait for God's moving in our life. The third principle that I want to talk about today is the principle of listening to what God says. Breakthrough prayer includes not just me talking to God and crying out to God or begging God. As I said, it's not begging God. It's telling God desperate in desperation, God, if you don't come through and there's nothing I can do, is listening to God. Prayer is always communication. It's me speaking to God, but it's also God speaking to me. And so the king was not only crying out to God, but he was willing to listen to what God had said. And of course, the great revival of chapter 19 had reminded the king of the great authority and power of the Word of God. And he got the Word of God out and called the people back to the Word of God. Listen to this. Verse 15 through 18, it says, "This is what the Lord says to you. Do not be afraid or discouraged because of this vast army, for the battle is not yours, but God's." God's saying, listen, don't be discouraged. Don't be afraid. "You won't need to fight this battle," God says. "Just take up your positions and stand still." Wait on the Lord, he's saying. "And then just wait and watch, and you will see the Lord deliver you. Again, do not be afraid or discouraged because the Lord is with you." Then the king and everyone else all bowed to the ground and worshiped God. God talks to us through His Scripture. And that's why I want to be specific in this message about this today. It's important, I believe, this principle of listening to God. Because when I'm desperate and when I need a breakthrough in my life, whatever that is, that it might be a financial, it might be a physical thing, it might be a family matter, it may just be a spiritual breakthrough in your life that you need God to break through. Like in our culture, 2 Chronicles 7:14, that we would humble ourselves and pray and seek His face and turn from our wicked ways so that God's forgiveness could be brought about in our land and healing could come. That's a desperate prayer, a breakthrough. But sometimes when we want a breakthrough, we're more like this. God, show me in some sign that you're attentive to my ear. And of course, that was Gideon laying out fleeces before God. I want to tell you something. I'm going to talk about Gideon in a few weeks. But I don't need to lay out a fleece before. I don't need to look and break through prayer for a sign in the sky, because God has given me something better than that. He has given me the written Word of God. Now, Gideon didn't have that. We have that. Sometimes people say, well, Gideon looked for a sign. Listen, this is a whole dispensation of time. We have the Word of God. So don't be looking for a sign in the sky. Look for a Scripture from the Word of God. Because God's Word contains God's will. An entire nation humbled themselves, and they bowed, and they worshiped God, and they were waiting for God to work. But they were going to believe what God had said through His prophet. Now listen, what God said to him, He says to us. In our desperation, while we're waiting on God. This is what God is saying. Let me just put it in our terms. Relax. When you're waiting on God, relax. Don't be afraid or discouraged, He said. I am able. I am God. What is impossible with man is not impossible with me. It's not your battle. It's my battle. You know, God is never disappointed in His people because they don't do what they cannot do. As a father, I know that I love taking care of my kids. That's what fathers do. Fathers take care of their kids. They love to, hey, don't worry about that. I would hate to think that the twins, we go to sleep worried to death whether or not they're going to have a meal tomorrow. That's not their place to worry about that. That's my responsibility. Listen to me. God says, relax. Fathers take care of their children. Realize that. That's the second thing. Realize it's God's battle, and He can handle it. But we often try to assume God's role in things. And there are certain things that the twins have to leave to Paulette and I. They can't fix it, but we can. And we already knew about it. We'd already planned to do it. And they don't need to worry about it. So relax and then realize that God is God and we're not. And He's not expecting us to be God. He's not expecting us to do what is impossible for us to do. But He is expecting us to trust Him and wait on Him. And then resist trying to get involved and just get the situation messed up. Keep serving in the position. Keep playing the role that God has for you to play. Now, that's very hard because, as I said, in desperation, sometimes we get thinking, well, you know, if it's to be, it's up to me. We talked about that last week. No, if it is to be, it is up to God. It's not up to us. And remind ourselves that we're to wait and we're to watch. So just stand, the Bible says, know this, that God has never lost a battle. Can you imagine God losing a battle? Well, it's never going to happen because He's God. You will see the Lord will deliver you, He said. We think sometimes, well, you know, this desperate situation, I just need to get out from under it. I just need to leave it. And sometimes we're so distressed when our world is falling in on us and we're praying in desperation for a breakthrough and we're waiting on God. And sometimes we just want to think, man, I'm just going to get in my car and take off driving. I'm just going to drive until I can't drive any further. Thinking somehow if I were just running from this, if I were just getting out from this, that somehow I could deliver myself. But here's the problem. Your discouragement and your stress is not in the air, it's between your ears. And so wherever you go, it's going with you. And you can't escape it. I just want to tell you, it's never God's will for us to run from a difficult situation in our life. And that's what many of us want to do. God has never lost a battle. I often want to run. So I can relate to you. I mean, I was just thinking this morning. Matter of fact, jokingly, kind of, I said to Paulette this morning, man, it'd just be great to get in the car and just start driving. Because there are situations that are continually crumbling in, falling in around us. But I want to tell you something. It is never God's will for His children to run from a situation, even though we might want to. Because as I said, the problem is not in the air. The problem is in our head. And we can't get away from that. It's going to go with us. And so we need to realize that we need to trust God. And here's the fourth principle. Thank God in advance for the answer. Look at verse 21. Then the king appointed musicians and singers in the choir and choir robes and marched them in front of the army and loudly praised and thanked the Lord. This is what they sang. We thank God, His love never quits. That's out of the New Living Testament. We thank God, His love never quits. And so we praise God for the victory because it's thanking God in advance. That's the breakthrough prayer. You know, the Bible says that God inhabits the praise of His people. Look at verse 22. And at the moment they begin to sing and to praise, the Lord calls the armies to begin to fight among themselves. Now realize, some 185,000 people in this great army, united from three different kings, was coming against them. There was no way that Jehoshaphat and the people of Judah was going to be able to stand against them. Miraculously, at the very moment they begin to praise, the Lord calls the armies to begin to fight among themselves. And listen, they destroyed each other. So when you're going to When are you going to put the choir out in front of your desperate situation? By that I mean, when are you going to start praising God, thanking Him in advance for what He's going to do? I've been praying for some people in the church and who've been ill. And last night, it just came to me. I'd been thinking about this message that I'm going to be preaching today. And I thought, you know, I've been praying for them. And I've been praying for them. But I haven't been praying with faith for a breakthrough in their life. And so last night, I began praying, God, I thank you in advance that you're going to touch their bodies. And your healing power is going to flow to them. And can I tell you, not just by coincidence, I don't think, that this morning I got a text, hey, I woke up fever gone. I woke up feeling better. I believe that God honored a breakthrough prayer in their life. So even though I'm preparing this message, I've been studying it for weeks, I can just tell you that you have to be intentional or you won't pray like this. And so when are you going to start setting the choir out in front of your impossible situation that you need a breakthrough? Listen to me. The moment they started praising God, thanking Him in advance for what God was going to do, they had no way. They didn't imagine in their wildest imagination that somehow these armies were going to be confused and attacked each other and kill one another. They had no way of knowing that. God had that plan. That was part of God's plan. And the moment that they started thanking God in advance, that's faith, God gave a breakthrough. Number five, expect God to turn battles into blessings when I do this. Look at the Word of God again. Look at verse 24. When the army of Judah finally arrived at the battleground, the valley was covered with dead bodies as far as they could see. No one had survived. So they went out and gathered the plunder and valuables, more than they could carry back. In fact, there was so much loot, it took 3 days for them to collect it all. On the fourth day, they gathered for worship service in the valley which they named the Valley of Baraka. In the Hebrew, the word Baraka means blessing. The valley of battle became the valley of blessing when they got a breakthrough. And I'm going to tell you, that's going to be true for you and me. The Bible says, because the people had thanked and praised God there. When we allow God to fight our battles, we reap more benefits than we can handle. I want to tell you, my friend, God wants to bless our lives. And when I'm willing to wait on God and I'm willing to pray in faith and thank God in advance for His victory, God is working on me. He's changing me. He changed Jehoshaphat and the army. It wasn't at all the way that they would have fought a battle. They would have always sent the army out first, but God had changed them, the way they were thinking. We're just going to praise God. This is His battle. It's beyond our consideration anyway. And they returned every man, the Bible says, to of Jerusalem with Jehoshaphat in front of them to go back to Jerusalem with joy, for the Lord had made them rejoice over their enemies. Listen to me. When you pray in faith for a breakthrough, you will have a testimony to the world and you will love and know God better and trust Him more in the future. It's impossible for you to have a breakthrough when everything was against you and yet God brought the victory. It's impossible for anything in your life, not to ever be the same. You will never think about God again. You'll never think about prayer again in the same way. You prayed specifically, and God in power answered that prayer and did what you know is humanly impossible to do, something that was supernatural. But not only are you going to receive more than you can absolutely believe if you live by faith and trust God in faith, and not only are you going to have a testimony in the world and your love and knowledge of God will be at a greater capacity than you've ever experienced. But can I tell you something else? God will be glorified in the world. Listen to what happened, verse 29. And the fear of God was on all the kingdoms of those countries when they heard that the Lord had fought against the enemies of Israel. I want to tell you, my friend, whenever you have a breakthrough in your life, not only will you have a testimony, but other people will say, my goodness, there's something different about those people. God is real. This God is not just a concept. God is not just an idea. But God is a person, and God is at work in the world. And I see their testimony, and I know their life, and I know that's a reality. Unbelievers will start to notice God. Your testimony will have power and witness. Listen to me. Your greatest tool of evangelism, as I've been saying, is your testimony. Listen, you know that there cannot be a testimony without a test. And you have these tests, and God breaks through, and you've got this glorious testimony. It's your story, and nobody can argue with what your story is because it's your story. And I want to tell you, my friend, this is how to have a breakthrough. It's not just praying and thanking God for what He's done in the past. It is praying in faith. And that's what Jesus said in the very first scripture that I read this morning. Jesus said, anytime you ask for anything in prayer, believe that you have received it, and you will receive it. In other words, breakthroughs are accomplished through praying in faith. Father, I pray for everyone who is watching and listening to this message today, would take seriously this biblical story. You know, you tell us in your word, God, that these stories in the Old Testament were given to us for lessons to us today, so we could learn the spiritual principles. Lord, I'm praying for a breakthrough in my life, and I'm praying for a breakthrough in our church. Father, the vision that you've given me is impossible for us to accomplish. Lord, I know that it is, but Lord, I thank you right now in advance. Just as I was walking 3 years ago around this property, it seemed so impossible. And yet, God, we are already seeing the stirring of the Spirit of God in this community and in this church and in this region, as many men and women, boys and girls are coming. They're coming to faith in Christ. They're coming to your church that worships here, God. I thank you in advance because, Lord, I know that you are a God of breakthrough. You are the God who does that which is impossible with us. And so, Father, I pray that you would give us breakthroughs. Help us to faithfully pray as King Jehoshaphat. And Lord, that we would have the same kind of outcome. Lord, not any way at all that he expected it to go the way it did, but that was your plan, God. We don't know your plan, but we know this, God, that you have a plan, and we want to be faithful to be a part of it. So I pray you would draw men and women, boys and girls to yourself, Lord, today. Help them to know that that's where it starts, in a personal relationship with you. And then, Lord, I pray that not only would you draw them to you, Lord God, but I pray that, Lord, their life would be so transformed, there would be such a breakthrough that even their family wouldn't even recognize they're so different. Things are so changed. And they would find a church home, Lord. I pray that they'd find this as their place, that they'd give their testimony of baptism, Lord. Father, they could put on display their testimony that my sins have been buried with Christ. I've been risen to walk in a new life with you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. Amen. 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 May His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May His presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you. He is with you in the morning and the evening. And you're coming and you're going, and you're weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, He is for you. Oh, oh. He is for you. Oh, oh.
Thank you for joining us online today. We are so glad that you were a part of the service. If you have any questions about what it means to have a relationship with Jesus Christ, about baptism, or how to join our family at Central Baptist Church, we would love to answer your questions. You can use Facebook Messenger to send us a message, or you can call or email the church. You will find our phone and email information on our website. Thank you again for worshiping with us today. And may God bless you and give you peace.